Live, start it.
Go for it.
Welcome back. We're here at 505 Uncut Live. We're here at the ABQ Collective store.
In the backyard, backyard flea market's
going live. On right now. We are actually live, people. I'm not joking either.
Like usually.
Like usually. You know, Daniel, Derek in the house. We got a special guest right here. We're going to have people coming up on the podcast live, kind of showing off what they do, their skills, their art, promoting themselves. So our first guest that we have on is Trisha Martinez. What's up, guys?
How you doing?
How are you? Welcome to the podcast.
I appreciate you having us.
Yeah,
you guys are with Albuquerque Dukes, correct?
Yeah, Albuquerque Dukes Against Child Abuse. We're a nonprofit. We just came up now in April. And
awesome.
We'll be hosting an event out here on June 5th.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about that? How did you start getting that going?
So it was originally supposed to be just a Facebook group, but it ended up, everyone's like, well, how can I come out? How can I support? Is there going to be an event? Is there going to be? And then so I ended up getting it licensed with the state. I got the name registered. Everything's legit. And so we came door knocking, trying to just get an event going. And Papa's Tacos offered us a space, and then Albuquerque Collective. So now we're hosting our first welcoming event, which is also a charity fundraiser for La Mesa Elementary.
Nice.
So we'll be raising...
Yeah, so I see you guys were going to do a car show, right?
Yeah.
Is that going to be at the school?
No, it'll be here.
Oh, here.
Yeah, it's going to be here from the end of Basil Leaf all the way through Albuquerque Collective. And we're going to also...
Oh, that's right. Yes, you told me that.
Yeah, and then we're going to have back... The backyard market as well, from 2 to 6. We're going to have a couple DJs, a couple performers, a dance team.
Is that all profits? You said it all going to the kids also?
Yeah, it's all going to go for 400 backpacks filled with school supplies for La Mesa Elementary.
Yeah, that's going to be
how
awesome.
How awesome is that, guys?
Yeah.
That's what that's how it's all about, is helping out.
We'll definitely be here to contribute for sure.
Yeah, yes, hopefully I can get you guys out here to do a podcast that day as well.
Yes, we'll be down.
We could do that.
Definitely.
We could do that.
Yeah, awesome.
Definitely.
Oh, that's awesome. How did you get into, like, trying to help the kids and trying to, like...
I'm also a social worker for the state. I work for Income Support Division, Human Services for Institutional Care and Waiver.
Oh, awesome. You probably know one of our friends. Doesn't Ivan work for that? YDI.
Yeah, and then I also bought a fixer-upper out in the southeast, and I got to know kind of the community.
Yeah.
I'm like, man, this neighborhood needs a lot of work. And then I have a little one. I'm a victim of child molestation and all that. So, I'm just trying to give back and help kids.
You don't want people to go through what you went through.
No, not at all.
Definitely not.
No.
What's up, Ethel? You want to say hi?
That's my daughter, Bianca. She's going to be one of the dance...
Talk into this mic, Ethel.
She's going to be
say
one
hi.
Of the dance
hi.
Performers.
Awesome.
Tell
Bianca,
them what you're doing on Saturday.
What Saturday?
For the event.
Oh, I'm going to be a hip-hop dancer.
You're going to be a hip-hop dancer?
Dance in motion.
Ooh, nice. I'm looking forward to seeing that.
Maybe we could have a dance-off, me and Daniel against you.
Shall we do it?
Yeah.
But it has to be the Michael Jackson music. That's the only music I know how to dance to.
Stays quiet.
But that's awesome. That's awesome that you guys are doing all this and helping the community. Much respect. That's what Albuquerque needs for sure, 100%.
Yeah.
There's so much craziness going on in the world right now. A lot of negativity, but we like to focus on the positivity, and I think that's what's going on right here at the ABQ Collective and the Backyard Market, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Definitely. Anything else you guys working on after? What's in your future plans?
We're just going to give back. We're going to host some more events. We're going to try to just pick another school, hopefully, to help rotate schools. Just kind of get out there and see where we can partner with. We have a few partners with other nonprofits. So we just partnered with Lifestyle Fitness. They're one of our nonprofit partners. The Robert Sotella Foundation.
Yeah.
And then we just picked up CYFD. They're going to be out here at the event.
Awesome.
We're going to have a ton of resource booths. So we just want to help kids. I mean, if there's a child in danger or you know a kid that needs help, just let us know so we can get them some resources. We have a ton of resources, food stamps, Medicaid.
Yes.
CYFD applications. Anything they need, they can reach out to me. My cell phone number is 505-408-0403, and we're also on Facebook under Albuquerque Dukes ACA.
Trisha Martinez, guys.
And we'll definitely put your card up when we got this going on.
Okay.
Be on the podcast. We'll put
it
in the
things. Well, I appreciate you.
For sure. Do you have like an Instagram handle or anything like that?
Stephanie Sanchez, that's my girlfriend. She's actually handling all of my social media stuff. And then she takes care of pretty much my Instagram, my Facebook, my Snapchat, all that stuff. So
awesome.
Awesome. Definitely.
Thank you so much for everything that you're doing. That's really inspiring.
And, yeah, for sure.
And I'm sorry for everything that you had to go through growing up and stuff, but I'm so happy that you're helping other kids and trying to make their lives better.
What doesn't kill you makes you stronger,
yeah.
Right?
Yep, exactly. Yeah,
make it a positive.
Yeah, make it a positive.
You got to.
Definitely. Definitely.
Yeah.
And we will be here when you have the car wash. We'll be supporting 100%.
And just word of advice, if you're going through something, I mean, ask for help. Don't
ignore
hold it.
It
all in. Tell somebody.
Yes,
or if
exactly.
You know a family in need or something, just tell somebody. There's resources.
Even as things as like kids being bullied, I know yeah. That Jackson's gym, like if you could talk to them
mm-hmm.
And they help kids that get bullied and they give them like free training sessions
yeah.
And stuff like
that's
that.
That's what
to
Lifestyle Fitness is doing.
Yeah.
They're one of the nonprofits that's going to be out here. So the way it works is they have a nonprofit for athletes. So if there's a family that or a student that wants to play sports, but the family can't cover the cost, Lifestyle Fitness helps fundraise
oh, wow.
For that
oh,
cost.
Yeah. Lifestyle Fitness.
Yeah, so they're also on Facebook. They'll be here on Saturday, June 5th. So if you do have a family or a student that wants to play sports, they can't cover the cost, come talk to Lifestyle Fitness, please.
Please.
Yeah. Man, that's all good
that
stuff.
That is all good. That's something that you want these kids to get on, something positive that's going to keep them busy from staying out of trouble. And focus on their athletics or playing sports or, you know,
exactly.
Whatnot. It's just, that's the best thing to do for kids nowadays.
Yep.
Instead of going and stealing and breaking the cars
yeah.
And
exactly.
Spray painting the fence. And
a lot of these kids are running around with guns these days.
I know.
It's crazy.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Crazy. Little,
that's why
little
the community
kids.
Needs to come together.
Yep.
You just need to find something for them to do. Find a vacant building, ask the owner if we can paint it up. Let them do their thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Instead
real.
Of getting in trouble.
Exactly.
Well, everybody out there better watch out because I'm already working on my Batman suit. Batman's going to start showing up in Albuquerque.
Yeah.
Let me know.
With the Batmobile.
I'll roll with you.
You're going to see a vigilante.
Yeah.
Albuquerque vigilante.
Well, there's going to be number
two over
here.
Well, you're not supposed to let them know that you're Batman.
Well, I'm not. It's still in the process.
Now you're
going
to have to pick a different one.
It's going
to
be a Burke Batman. The Burke Bat.
Burkeño.
Carl's bad bat or something. Maybe we'll go with something local.
Yeah.
He's from the caverns, eh?
Make sure your cape says Burkeño.
Yeah.
Burkeño.
For real, no.
That dude's a mutated bat from the caverns, bro. He came from Carlsbad.
I know.
Right?
Did you see that guy?
So, that's funny.
It's good times. I
but
love
definitely,
it.
Yeah, we got to get this city back on positivity,
back on track,
man. Yeah.
Yeah, we need more people like you and...
Yes.
In our city and definitely in the world for sure.
Definitely.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
100%. And always, we're always here to reach out. We're always here to help.
Yeah.
Help you guys.
Cool. Thank you.
Help
appreciate
kids.
All of you guys. Thank
did
you so
did
much.
Did you hit that get on embarrassed with the dance off? Next week? When is it? I'm going to mark the date
June
down.
5th. We're, June 5th. We're, June I guess 5th. We're going to do a dance off with 505 Uncut.
Yeah. We sure can.
Yeah. We're going
to
mix
last
it
time
up.
We got a little kid that wanted to
or
dance off with us.
Or we should just do adults. Adults against kids. Let's do it.
Yeah.
There you go. There you go.
Last
all
time
right,
we
so
were
who
about
wants
dancing
to do it?
Some little kid, he was telling us, what you going to do? Just sit there all night?
Yeah.
What do you do? Yeah. What was he telling us?
Yeah, some little, he was all, what, five?
Yeah.
That's
he
my,
was like five or six. He was seven?
That's my little hito now. I'm his uncle. But
he's
yeah,
got a Snapchat.
Yeah.
What's a Snapchat?
We did a dance battle.
No, it's a TikTok. Oh, it's
a
TikTok.
Yeah. But he was telling
he's
us.
He's a little rapper. He's a rapper, too.
Oh, snap.
He was telling
we got to
get
him on stage.
Yeah.
He's like, what are you going to do? Sit there all night? And he was all.
He was telling Daniel, we're going to sit there
can
all night.
Can we get him on stage
up?
That day?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, we're going to have
him.
Yeah,
let me know.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
Yep. He's not afraid.
DeAndre 2003. All right, we got to get him on
DeAndre 2003. Check him out on TikTok.
Someone from my team,
my
please find him.
That's my hito that he doesn't know yet.
Except he's afraid of dogs.
Yeah, he's afraid of dogs, yeah. Yeah, he's afraid of dogs. Good kid, though. Yeah, we had a dance battle, and then he was afraid to dance him, so I had to step up.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm down.
Yeah.
I'm good for it.
You took,
I've been
you
trying
took,
to get
he took
dance
his shoes
team
off and everything.
Yeah. He did the sprinkler on me, though. I couldn't come back on that one. He went like that.
Yeah, he did.
I'm famous for the running man.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Yeah. I didn't know what to do after he hit me with the sprinkler. I just stood there.
Oh, man.
So. Anything else you guys want to add on?
No, just come out, check out the event June 5th, Dance in Motion. They're a dance team. They're always looking for some new talent. So if you want to join them, come check out. If you need any resources, Rape Crisis Center is going to be here. City of Albuquerque, CYFD, Army National Guard is going to bring out an arcade trailer. So just come out, have some fun, have some food, meet some good people.
And please come support. Come support local people. Everybody that listens, come support. And it's a nice to come out, see the people, see what everybody has to offer, and help the kids.
The ABQ Collective Backyard Market, guys.
ABQ Dukes.
We're just going to do like 15-minute segments here, so we'll be back. We'll be back here in a bit.
Thanks again.
Thank you, Trisha.
Thanks, Trisha. Appreciate it.
Yeah, that camera's recording us, but we're just stopped bullshitting.
Oh, okay,
yeah,
right.
We're just talking.
Cool.
Hell yeah. Just going to get some, talk about your bike, about your custom building. Just talk a little bit. Yeah, about yourself.
All right.
We're back live, guys. 505 Uncut. We have a special guest in the house again.
Yes, sir. Aaron, right?
Yeah.
Aaron Gonzales from Stilokustomz.
Stilokustomz.
Yes, sir.
Look at this beautiful bike.
He custom makes these bikes, man. This thing is nice.
Cuts them, puts them together. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that, brother?
I kind of started 4 years ago. I came across a couple bikes online, and at the time they were going for $700 a frame, and I couldn't get myself to break on spending that much on a frame. So I was like, well, I could buy $400 or $500 worth of material and just keep on trying. And it kind of just took off from there. And I had a cousin, he worked for the railroad. He moved back to California, but he kind of was one that kind of pushed me to kind of start doing it, you know? So, and I worked for the city of Albuquerque as well. And a friend of mine, I didn't know how to weld or anything, so a friend of mine there, he's a welder, and he, I would bring him pieces of tubing, and I'd say, hey, can you weld this, and he's all, what the hell are you doing, and I was like, I'm making a bike, and he's like, all right, so he kind of taught me how to weld, and, you know, he ended up leaving the city, and at that point, he was like, you gotta do this on your own, you sink or swim, and so I just kind of ran with it, and 4 years later, bro, like, I probably got over 40 bikes under my belt. And,
really?
Yeah. Awesome. I was actually
really nice,
in a build-off last year for COVID. I was going against a guy from Spain, Florida, Texas, two from California, and we're supposed to do an unveiling in Vegas.
Yeah.
And it was a big old thing, bro, and it fell through, you know, because of COVID. But but now it's just, you know, typically, it's just my hobby, and, like, but I do build for certain people, or if I have a connection with you, then I'll build something. You know what I mean? Like,
and these bikes are big time in Cali for sure. The beach cruisers and stuff.
Bro, like,
big time.
There's a ride right now going on this weekend in Yuma, and it's probably 300 plus bikes.
Wow.
You know what I mean? Like, and they have once a year they have this this big show, and it's like a 5-day ride, like in Vegas.
Yeah.
And it's called OBC, and. Well, there's over 1,000 people that go to it. You know what I mean? It's a bike show. I mean, you name it, bro. Like, it's these bikes, I don't think that they've been exposed. I mean, it's some people are, they've never seen nothing like it.
Yeah.
You know, and so
I've seen a few of those shows where the competition is fierce in these bike shows.
Yeah.
And I mean, the cuts gotta be perfect, the bolts gotta be perfect, everything, they judge everything. Just like a car show, bro.
Yeah, just like
a car show. It's a beautiful, beautiful bicycle though. Top notch.
I've always been curious. Is that bike hard to ride?
No, bro. It's actually like, it's kind of as like a recumbent feel. It's like foot forward design, as opposed to like a regular bike, you're pedaling
foot down. Yeah.
And
this is like Harley style foot forward.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
wow.
Yeah.
But it just depends too. Like, I like my stuff low, nice and tight.
Yeah. When it's so low like that, when you take a right turn, you got to make sure your right pedal's up. No.
Oh yeah.
Because otherwise the pedal will hit the floor, huh?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. But a lot of people are like, can you build me a bike? And I'm like, as long as you understand you're going to hit, because it's probably like at least 1 or 2 inches off the ground.
Yeah.
You know, and so.
What's your estimated time on putting a bike together? Have you rebuilt it for somebody?
It varies, bro, because like I said, like, I got a full-time job. I have my daughter. You know, I got family, you know, that takes priority
your life,
over
yeah.
everything. And then, you know, when I have time, like I said, I come to this for my outlet.
Like a hobby?
Yeah, exactly,
yeah.
But I love it, bro. Like, it's my passion, and it's, I'm going to be 40 next Saturday, and it's crazy that it took me this long to find.
To find what you really wanted to do?
Yeah, bro, like I put my heart and soul into this, bro, and it's like,
not
a lot of people don't find that, you know what
yeah.
I mean?
Yeah.
You're not the only
one.
You know
what? That's a really good point to be made. Like, not everybody not everybody even finds what they would love and what they want to do.
Yeah.
And everybody goes to this nine to, we live in this rat race of 9 to 5 and everything. And that, for a lot of people, it sucks. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, some people love it, but most of the people out there just hate it. And just because you're going to be 40 or whatever, that's cool that you were able to find it. You know what I mean? Yeah. I think that's pretty inspiring. And
well, even that, we talked with Tommy Ray, shout out to Tommy Ray. You had brought it up about finding grown men don't find their way until what? You until said 35?
To 35.
About 35, 40-ish is when you...
About between 35 and 40 is about when men start really...
Maturing.
And maturing.
I can
and
see that.
Figuring out what they really want, who they really want to be, what they really like.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because when you're in your 20s, it's all about cars and girls and...
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Trying to make as much money as you can.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Yep. And then you blow all that money in a weekend.
Down in your mid-30s and you're like... What's really going to make me happy? Because money doesn't make you happy. Yeah. You know what I mean? It can make you happy for a little while. Like that country song. Yeah. Money doesn't make you happy, but money buys a boat, and it buys a truck that pulls my boat.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
You know what I mean? Like that kind of situation. Yeah.
You know what it is that, like, when you're in your 20s, your testosterone's all going through the roof, and you just don't think straight. You're thinking with the wrong head.
Yeah.
But when you get in your 30s and 40s, that shit slows down, and then you kind of fucking get refocused.
You need to get on that CRT.
You get the fake testosterone.
Yeah.
Right. And you literally slow down. You know
slow
what I mean?
Down.
Yeah, like, you don't have a choice. Your body tells you, you need to slow
you the fuck
down.
You need to slow the fuck down. You said you're going to be 40 next Saturday, and happy early birthday to you for that.
Thank you.
I turned 40 in January.
Oh, right on.
And the first fucking doctor appointment I went to, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, bro. Oh, and I was like, what? And then
it comes with the age.
And I was like, for real? And then he's like, if you keep going at this pace, you're going to be having a heart attack by next year if you don't start slowing down. Like so I have to go on a special diet, chicken and fish and vegetables, got to lower the cholesterol. But it just... shit that happens to us when we get older, you know?
Yeah, that's the way it goes, bro.
Your body starts slowing down and breaking down eventually, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Live forever.
You can't live forever, man.
No.
So you gotta be happy while you're here.
Unless you're the Hulkster.
Yeah. Hulkamania,
running wild.
I don't know. He's looking pretty old,
I know he is.
Dude, did you see how old Mayweather looked? Did you guys see all those videos?
Oh, yeah.
Are you a fight fan?
What's the dude's name that took his hat?
Ray Paul.
Yeah, or Jake Paul.
Jake Paul, Ray
Paul. You think that was staged?
Probably, for the money.
Dude, Mayweather looked pretty pissed.
Mayweather socked him in the face and gave him a black eye.
Yeah.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, he busted him up.
Shit, okay.
Yeah. He busted him up.
Yeah, I missed that part.
And they actually have
he probably broke his hand.
They actually have a still picture of, what's his name, Jake Paul?
Jake Paul is the little brother, and Logan Paul is the one that Mayweather's fighting.
Yeah, they show a still picture of him scared to death. Like, Mayweather's bodyguards are coming towards him, and his face is all frozen. He's like, oh, shit,
but
here he comes.
Isn't that brother, the Jake Paul or whatever, they're both pretty big dudes, right?
Yeah, like they're both pretty.
Mayweather's a small, he just reminds me of, like, a small little dude. Like,
but, man, he's so talented, though. Yeah, yeah, dude, he's talented.
I mean, are they in the same weight division or?
Not even, dude.
Not even.
Okay. Mayweather's like a flyweight or a lightweight?
Flyweight.
And Jake Paul's probably a welterweight. Welterweight, like 185.
Yeah.
Mayweather fights like at 125, 135.
Yeah.
And Jake Paul probably fights at 185.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. So they're
realistically,
like,
they wouldn't be able to even fight each other if it.
No, if it was sanctioned and everything, they wouldn't be fighting each other.
Oh, so it was in stages, and I could see, like, if they were promoting something or, you know what I mean?
No, this is just straight exhibition fight that they're going to be having.
I got you.
You know what I found interesting was Ryan Garcia's training.
Ryan Garcia is taking time off, dude. You didn't see that?
Not Ryan Garcia. Who's the other one? The young kid that just signed with the Golden Boy. The up-and-comer that looks just like Oscar De La Hoya. Something Garcia.
I don't even know who he is.
Because they showed him the other day. He's training Paul they're to fight Mayweather. I can't think of his name right now. We'll have to come back to that one.
Yeah.
It's something Garcia, bro. It's not Ryan Garcia. It's the other one. Daniel Garcia?
Danny Garcia?
Danny Garcia, the young one. Young kid.
No, Danny's already almost on his way out.
No, he's a young kid that was coming up and from Cali.
I don't know.
He just signed.
We'll look this up.
He just signed with Golden Boy.
Later. Yeah.
Anyways, dude, I'm really interested in one of these bikes, man. I might be hitting you up. You got to give me your...
Okay.
Do you have like an Instagram or a Facebook that people can get a hold
of
you on?
Yeah, I do. My main page is Stilokustomz.
Stilokustomz.
Yeah, and then I'm part of a club as well. It's Oddfellas Bike Club. And we have chapters in California, Arizona, Texas, and Albuquerque is where we started. So Yeah, bro.
How can they hit you up? Can they hit you up through their Instagram?
Yeah, hit me up through the Stilokustomz main. And I control a lot of it. I control the main pages, like the Oddfellas, Albuquerque, and then the Stilokustomz. That's DM me on that. And I mean, the prices vary as well. And like the frames, typically, I can probably build a frame for a reasonable price, but the parts is.
I mean, expensive. That fork doesn't look like it's a cheap piece.
No, it's not. And then as far as the wheels goes, like these are 3-inch wheels, but then they have 4 and 5. So the wider the wheel you go,
the more expensive
it is. The more expensive, or, you know, even the spokes. It's 36 spokes. You can go up to 144.
I don't want to put you on the spot, but like, let's say a fully decked out bike, what do you think that's going to cost?
So if I cut up a bike, you're looking at around $600-700.
$1,000, people. That's how much they cost, okay?
Yeah.
So don't be coming with no bullshit. I want $250.
I got $625.
$1,000.
And especially if you want a custom bike, you got to pay the right price to get the quality work.
Yeah, this is handmade art.
Yeah, and a lot of people say, hey, how much for that bike? And I'll tell them, and they're like, I can go buy a bike like that at Walmart.
Go, okay.
No, you cannot. You know what I mean? Not like that.
I'm like, let me know where they sell those, because I'll go jump all over that.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah.
But a lot of times, too, like, if you could find out, like, Walmart sold these, they're called Mongoose Beasts, and they already have the fat rims. A lot of times, I find them on Craigslist for, like, $100, or if you can pick one of those up.
You could get all the parts off of it.
You got the wheels. I reuse the wheels, reuse the cranks. I reuse everything on there.
It's like a straight chopper, dude. You're talking about, like, straight chopper.
You know what's crazy?
You're chopping up bikes, but with no motors. That's what you're doing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, and my tools, too. Like, I got probably where people don't understand is, like, oh, why do you charge so much? Well, anything custom is going to be expensive. I don't care what it is.
Exactly.
And then
mind, $650 is not that much, dude.
No, it's
not for a piece of art like this.
No, bro. I mean, I'm not getting rich. It's just keeping me going.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, I got a frame jig. My jig alone was over $1,000.
I was gonna ask you that. Yeah. You got a jig and everything to put
my
to
welder,
weld it
my,
up.
My roller, my benders, like my roller, I think, or my actual bender, I have over $1,500 in one tool.
Just so people know, that's the way he bends the pipes, like that down pipe that's there. You can't just put straight pipes on these bikes. It has to be bent to go around the wheel and all of that stuff.
Yeah.
And all that stuff takes engineering and thought and knowing how to measure it and bend it the correct way. Because if it's not cut,
it's not gonna
and
right,
bent
right.
and welded in the correct way, the bike is no good.
Oh, yeah. The geometry, everything.
The geometry matters. The rake of the fork and everything, all that stuff matters.
That's what I was going to touch upon is... I think people that have, you know, that say, oh, I can get it at Walmart or whatever, don't really know what they're about bikes, about the custom, or about anything. But there are people that do, and the people that do will understand the price and what they're getting and what they're buying.
Yeah.
Not only that, I mean, even if you compare, like, going to, like, the Fat Tire bike shop.
Yeah.
And buying a Walmart bike, those are completely two different bikes.
Yeah.
They look the same, but they're not the same.
Yeah.
They're not the same in any way. Just like this is a whole different beast in itself, too.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And, like with these bikes, too, like, Stilo is, you know, I named it Stilo because it's my style.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's not typically everyone's style, but it's my style.
Yeah.
So if this is something that you're interested in, then more than likely we have the same style. But these bikes are always say, like, it's a representation of who you are. Like, some people like rat rods. Some people like the shiny stuff, you know, and I like the rat stuff. You know what I mean? Because this bike could fall and I can just tell you, leave it there.
Yeah.
You know, I've had the bikes where they were shiny and I was always protecting it and leave it alone, don't touch it, you know.
Yeah.
But to me, it's when you're on it, it's like, oh, this is my style, you know what I mean? Like, just like your shoes or just like, you know,
it's your flavor.
Exactly, you know. Yeah. So to me, that's what makes it fun as well, because I can hand a raw frame off to you and I could say, oh, I would build it up like this.
Yeah.
But then you take it to a whole nother level and you're like, I'm gonna do it like this. And it just kind of like, that's what I enjoy too. I have a guy in Chicago. I sent him a frame. And man, I wish I had pictures of it. This bike, bro, is so sick, bro. Like, I never knew he was going to take it that direction. And that bike is, I always say, like, hey, let's trade. Like, I'll give you two frames and I'll do this to get that bike back. You know, just because to me, it was like I gave him a raw canvas, a raw piece of art, and then he put his art on it. And then he takes pictures, and that becomes art. And, like, it's like overlapping. You know what I mean? Like, to me, it's like
it's just a, everybody has different talents and everybody has different visions.
Yeah.
And that's what I think is so like awesome with art and bike. I mean, everything is just so awesome when you can see people's ideas are just amazing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I like that light. Is that vintage?
It's actually so my cousin, like I said, he worked for the railroad.
Yeah.
It's a vintage railroad lantern.
Oh, nice.
So they would carry it around, you know, at night. It had a handle, but my cousin was like, this would be a badass.
Yeah. I like
headlight.
That light.
That's tight, bro.
But yeah, it's fun, bro. Like, not everybody. Some people are like, I don't know how you design. Like, you come up with all these designs, and I don't have that vision. But then there's people that can take my frame and trick it out. And they call them cake decorators, right?
Yeah.
Because they can't make the frame, but they can take it to another level.
Yeah, they could put the lipstick on it.
That's what's cool about it, too. And, like, as far as the bike scene, bro, like, I always tell people, in this bike scene, if you ever, you guys are more than welcome, bro. I got bikes. If you ever want to take a trip to Phoenix or, you know, where the bike scene is big.
It's crazy.
I went out there my first time, bro, and it's, bro, like, everybody treats you like family, you know, and that's what made me stay in this bike scene, too, is yeah. that it's the people, bro. Like, I always say, like, the bikes are what brings us together, but the people's what make you stay.
Yeah.
Bro, I got people. I can say I'm going to California, and I have 10, 15, 20 people reaching out. Oh, stay at my house. You know, don't worry about a hotel, this and that. It's a big family, bro. And anybody that ever wants to look into it,
yeah,
bro, I would suggest, or I would at least go on one ride, bro, and I guarantee you'll be hooked. And it's not just custom bikes. It's BMXs. It's,
yeah,
and it's a family thing, bro. Like, my Hita, bro, like, I built her a bike. I built, you know, my daughter's mom. I built her a bike as well, and it could be a family thing. It's not. This isn't something where I was like, this is my thing. I got into it because I knew that at some point, my family could go riding, and you know, even you know, me and my Hita is always cruising around Albuquerque. You know, yeah. Like, or you know, and it's a good time to just kind of slow life down, bro. Like,
yeah.
In a car, yeah, you don't, for real, to you relax, don't hear what,
to relax.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
How's the bike scene here in Albuquerque? Is it pretty big?
It's
getting big.
As far as the custom bikes, there's a small community.
Yeah.
You know, and it ranges from, we have a guy, his name's Lauren, really good friend of mine. He's 70 years old. He rides, he's a religious rider, bro. That guy, I have pictures of him with his mocos frozen, bro. Like, yeah. Him riding in the winter, he'll ride in the rain, snow, whatever. Yeah. But the scene, I'm trying to get it to go, you know, grow. And
you know what scene just popped in my head when you said that?
What's that?
The Dumb and Dumber scene when they're on the motorcycle going back to Aspen, Colorado.
Well, I always wanted to redo that. I wanted to redo that picture. Maybe you guys could do it on the bike. Yeah, like, I could take you.
Just go, hey, man.
I was gonna say, me and Derek haven't really ridden bikes in a long time. Do you recommend we get one of those German
helmets, the aerodynamic helmets, and then, ones,
elbow pads and knee pads?
Oh yeah, yeah. And then you could like get it wrapped with the sarape or
yeah,
whatever,
there you
like
go.
The Mexican blanket. That way it looks good. You're right.
That's funny.
Oh yeah, hey, well, brother, dude, thanks for coming on, man. I really like your bike, man. Cool stuff.
Thank Aaron you, Gonzalez.
Aaron Gonzalez, Stilokustomz, right? Stilokustomz.
Yeah, Stilokustomz.
Check him out. Custom, you guys want a custom bike? Hit him up.
He'll get you done.
Thanks for coming on the show, bro. And this is our winner for our patch last week.
Oh, yeah,
our last show.
The one that won the patch last week.
Yeah. Burke, New Mexico. You guys tune in. 505 Uncut.
505 Uncut.
Hell yeah. Thank you.
It's a little early for that. Wake you right up.
Yeah.
All right, guys, we're back. We got another guest here. This is Patrick. And is that your wife or your girlfriend?
She's my fiance.
Your fiance, Erica. She's actually over at the booth because somebody has to man the booth over there.
Yeah.
This is Big Head Leather. They do custom wallets, custom, this is for a passport?
Yeah, it's a passport and
you
a field notes journal.
You can use it as
journal.
An itinerary.
Yeah.
Whatever you wanted to.
Yeah, well, I mean, we had a gentleman buy it. He works at a bar. He uses it to keep his notes at a bar. And,
yeah,
you
perfect.
Know, multi-purpose stuff.
A cool new design for a wallet.
Yeah, that one right there, that one's called a Stella wallet. It's our minimalist wallet. It fits everything you need. We keep it by, you keep all your main cards here on the outside.
Check out how it works, Derek.
Everything kind of fits nice and tight in the middle there. Give it a quick pinch, everything pulls out. tuck it back in. Everything stays nice and tight.
Awesome.
So this is my design. I'm really proud of it. It's been our best seller, and we're also selling a lot of bags as well, and they're going quickly. That's one of our bags walking by right over there, actually.
That's awesome.
We're having a great time. Last week was our first market, and everyone was really nice to us and had a lot of positive feedback, a lot of communication, and we're just happy to be here.
I love your the name of the business, Big Head, because I've been called that since I was about four.
And Big Mouth.
You know that, Big Mouth.
That's actually where the name of the company comes from, is the size of my head. Yep. I can't wear snapbacks because they don't fit.
Yep. Have you ever got sunglasses and the sunglasses break right in the middle and you try them on?
Or you have the big indentions on the side of the face.
Yes.
But, when I started the company and everyone was like trying to get me to sell stuff, I was trying to think of these names, and I had like Headstrong Leather or Broken Axe, or like all these macho masculine names, you know, and they just didn't really fit. And then my cousin walked in and he goes, "Why don't you just call it Big Head Leather? You've always had a big head." And I was like, "Hey, man, thank you."
Thank you.
But then I slept on it and I was like, That actually works.
Yeah, that actually works.
It's pretty good.
And that's a catcher, because everybody's all Big Head.
Yeah.
Because everybody's been called Big Head. That's what I'm saying. When I saw your shirt and I saw the card name and your business name, I was like, Big Head. That took me back to about kindergarten.
Everyone knows somebody with a big head.
Yep.
Yeah.
My dad used to always say I had a big head and big feet, and I was like those punching clowns. Like when you punch a clown and you go, and the clown will come back and then bounce right back up, you punch it again. Yeah.
Yeah. That's good parenting.
There you go. That was 80s, from the 80s.
Yeah.
But definitely, I love your designs, bro. Beautiful stuff. I love how you guys put the Zia symbol on
here. Yeah, and it's really good quality work, too, man.
Yeah, I have everything's hand cut, hand stitched by myself. I do it in my garage. I'm still telecommuting as well, so if you've worked with me or called me at my job, I'm most likely making one of these wallets while I'm talking to you.
Awesome.
So
what is the price? What is people spending on something like these? What are these going for wallet-wise?
Yeah, we have keychains and key clips all in different kinds of colors, all the way ranging down from $6. These wallets right here are $45. These ones here, these are more traditional bifold wallets. These are $60. Those journal covers are $30.
Not bad, dude.
Yeah. They're worth more than that.
There's a bag walking right there. that brown bag right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's... I keep selling them faster than I can make them.
Oh,
so everything's going great.
You guys check out Big Head. BigHeadLeather.com.
Yeah, my Instagram handle
is at Instagram Big Head, right there?
Yeah, it's at Big Head Leather.
Sorry, dude, I didn't mean to take it out of your hand.
Yeah.
At Big Leather on Instagram and Facebook.
And Facebook, then
www.BigHeadLeather.com.
That's correct.
A lot of talented people out here today. And actually, a lot of talented people. High quality. You guys check it out. Big Head.
Yeah, we have, a lot of people come up and they have like a wallet that they love, but they can't reconnect with it. They don't know where to buy it anymore. They'll pull it out and be like, this thing's about to fall apart, but I want another one. I'm open for commission. So if that's a scenario that you're in, shoot me a message on Instagram. There's a contact list at my website. And I'm always open for new challenges. So
I got a Venom watch I might hit you up on.
Yeah.
I have an old school Venom watch that's barely hanging on.
Yeah.
And I love it. I can't get rid of it.
Yeah. You just need new straps on it or what?
No, it's like about barely falling apart.
Yeah, it's kind of...
Oh, the wallet?
The wallet. Leather. But I'll hit you up.
I got you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure.
It's actually kind of annoying with my family where, like, every time they're like, I need something, like, I got you. I can make it out of leather.
Yep. There you go.
And, it might be driving my fiance away, but...
Is it hard to... Is it hard to manage a leather when you're stitching and you're sewing when it's really... You have to let it, like, kind of... Do you have to, like... Where it's not so hard. I'm trying to think of the word. Like,
well, it is a temperamental material for sure. I've made lots of mistakes and lost a lot of good leather. But through the couple of years that I've been doing this, you kind of learn tips and tricks along the way. And also the leather craft community is very inclusive, which I think in certain craft areas isn't necessarily the case. So I have a group of guys I'm in a group chat with all over the country, all over the world. That if I have a question, I could just shoot it to this group message and they'll give me 10 different answers. So
that's awesome.
It definitely, if you're looking to spend a lot of money on a hobby, leathercraft for
leather
sure.
Craft. Yeah, I can see that for sure. Because you got to be talented. You got to stitch. You got to make sure that everything's perfect, right? Just like we were talking about the bike earlier. It's the same thing in this. Craft.
Craft. Definitely.
Yeah, it it took a lot to kind of start selling my work because, you know, I always had that thought of like, who's going to want to buy this? But as soon as, you know, my fiance and my family and my friends kind of pushed me, the reception has been so great. And I think that's what's great about these markets is people are here and they want to buy this stuff. They don't want to go to these, you know, big box shops and buy all this stuff. They're here to buy stuff and meet the people that are making it. Yeah. And it's just so cool. And I wish I would have started doing it sooner because it's just been so great.
Awesome.
Yeah. And like for me, I was showing you, I have a coach wallet. Like, yeah, it's not even a wallet. It's the insert to the wallet that it came in.
Mm-hmm.
And I love this thing, man. But then somebody else, Mahito, my stepson, bought me a Versace wallet, and I don't even want to use it because it's too nice. You know what I mean? And it's like, eh. You know what I mean? But these wallets, dude, these are just as not, if not better than that Versace wallet.
Well, thank you. Yeah, this is...
And it's like a fraction of the price.
Right. Yeah, I mean, everything I make is made out of vegetable tan leather. Some of it's made here in the United States. Some of it's made in Italy. And vegetable tan leather, it absorbs the oils from your skin and, you know, through putting it in your jeans and pulling it out.
And it starts getting different colors and stuff.
It starts, you know, fitting to your cards and your cash in your pocket, and it becomes like an extension of yourself. So it's... You know, leather is just a beautiful thing that continues to age.
Yeah.
And, definitely. I mean, I could talk all day about leather, believe me.
Can you put any design in the leather, or does it have to be a specific design?
Well, actually, my brother has a 3D printer, and that's actually how we got these Zia stamps. They're kind of, I don't know if you'll be able to see it, but my brother has been 3D printing me stamps. So if you have a logo or a design, we are open, you know, if you're looking to make, you know, those journal covers for your employees, you know, we can put your company logo on that.
Yep.
And it doesn't cost anything extra. So it's super easy to make. And 3D printing, laser cutting, leather craft, it's all coming together.
Will this one hold business cards?
It will.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Perfect for business cards.
Yeah, I need one.
I love
heck yeah, man.
I love all your stuff, bro. That's really, really nice.
Yeah, thank you.
Really, really nice.
I don't know if the people could see the Zia stamp on this. Let me show you.
Do a close-up.
Yeah, you could take this one, too, if you...
This one, too. That's a red one. This is New Mexico style, too, bro. Like, a lot of people will like it because of the art and the design, and you'll be able to push it, sell it.
Yeah.
Definitely, bro.
Uh-huh.
Definitely.
Yeah, I mean...
impressive.
I'm you know, definitely trying to take advantage of the market because there's not too many leather crafters out here in New Mexico.
There isn't, no.
And if there are, you know, it's such an inclusive community. We want, you know, more people in the community. And
I think the last leather place that I seen was it Wilson's, or was the leather jacket place where we used to get all our leather jackets?
Yeah, but that was mass produced. Wilson's was mass produced.
Yeah, but I was saying
it wasn't a custom like this.
Seeing leather wallets and like everything was leather. I haven't seen a store around town that really sells that. Have you?
Not that I could think of. I know I've seen them like on YouTube and stuff, but not in town.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, he was saying that there's not a big.
There's not.
So.
Yeah, I mean that's kind of the next step. I'd love to work with, you know, there's. I don't want to name specific stores, but I mean one that I guess I will is like Brotique.
Yeah.
I love their stuff. You know, they're really powerful colors and stuff. It pretty much matches some of the style that I have, and I'd love to get into stores. And
you know what? I'm gonna have to get you with my sister, man. She does streetwear for Latinas, and she makes purses and all kinds of stuff, dude. Uh-huh. And I think you guys could do a good collab there.
Yeah,
I'll put you guys in contact for sure.
He has a big warehouse, bro. Designers, all kinds of stuff.
Yeah, for sure. These are all my designs, but I love a new challenge. You know, the best thing would be a lot of people come up, they'll show me a picture. Can you make this? And I'll give them a yeah or absolutely. You know.
Yeah.
So
the good thing is that you're willing to try.
Yeah, for sure.
Anything.
Yeah, the challenge is cool, and it's once. You know, once your brain kind of starts ticking that way and you're like, I can do that. I can definitely do that.
I was going to say, but I shouldn't use the word try because, like, quote from Yoda from Star Wars, there is no try, just do.
There is just do.
There is just do.
Yeah.
This
is
the
way. There's either do or do not. That's what he says. There is either do or do not. There is no try.
It was just May the 4th.
There's either do or do not. Yeah.
But aren't those words strong, though? Like, aren't those words, they touch you?
Well, it's the truth.
It's the truth.
It's
yeah.
the truth.
It is.
Like, there's a lot of dreamers out there, man, that's all they do is dream. You know, dreams come easy.
Dream and talk.
Talk comes easy. Dream comes easy. But to actually get out there and do it and start building what you wanted to build, and now it's starting to become successful, man. That's what it's all about.
Yeah.
That's the American dream. That's what I always say. Like, America, dude, is the land of opportunity filled with lazy-ass people.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, my hands hurt. You know, I spend, you know, hours in the shop. You know, my fiance has been incredibly supportive of me, you know, especially over the past 3 or 4 weeks trying to get stock, because pretty much everything I've been making has been to order. But coming into a market, you have to have stock. And so I'd wake up at, you know, 6 a.m. I'm in the shop by 6:30. I'm not done till 8:30 and we're eating dinner, go to bed and rinse, repeat for the past 3 weeks. And she's been incredibly supportive. So shout out to my fiance, Erica. I love you.
Hey, man, and there's nothing like working for yourself, too.
Yep. Sorry?
Hey, there's nothing like working for yourself.
Right.
Because, like, you know, we were just talking with
Aaron,
and I was telling him about, you know, the 9-to-5 rat race that this whole society is built around. And you're working way more than 9-to-5, but I'm sure it's way more gratifying and satisfying than working for somebody else.
Absolutely. I mean, especially, like, last week and today, you know, as people walk around and I see them carrying my products, it's a feeling that you can't really describe.
Huh?
Yeah,
it's
because
you get a tear to your eye.
Yeah, there's it's called imposter syndrome, where you're like, I'm not good enough. Like, I can do it, but I'm not good enough.
The feeling, man.
Yeah. And then once you start doing it, people are like, you're great at it.
I can do it.
Yeah.
My look at your quality is like Daniel just said, his Versace wallet, and he compared your wallets, your quality to Versace. What does that tell you? How good that looks?
Yeah, the price just went up, I guess.
Yep, there you go. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. Except you got to put your initials on there. BH. Big head.
Yeah. I really appreciate the comment, because, you know, every nice word and everything, like, it just justifies those long hours that spend. And
hard work.
And yeah, it's just been a great experience. It's almost more than we can handle. And ideally, I'd love to work for myself and quit the daily grind. You know, I still work while I'm, you know, making leather pretty much at the same time. And, you know, every time I have to do something for my job, I'm like, gah, I wish I could be leather crafting right now.
Yeah.
One day.
No,
brother.
You know what? Yeah. I think you're well on your way, man.
Yeah.
I definitely do. We need to get the word out on you more, because these are totally worth it, man.
Thank you.
You should be in all the stores and everything. I don't see why not. This is totally top quality stuff. Awesome, brother.
This is even Old Town, like stores in Old Town, bro.
Right.
You would sell all day. This is perfect for Old Town quality.
Yeah.
And there's so many shoppers that go through that place, bro. You would tear it up there, too. That's another
idea.
Hey,
have you thought about making YouTube videos?
I have, yeah.
You should do that.
Yeah.
Like, where it doesn't even necessarily have to be your face, but your hands, like, actually sewing the pieces and putting your stamps and doing all of that. And, dude, I think that might pump you up, too.
I would love to start doing that. But, I mean, just as you probably experienced with this podcast, you're like, I should start doing it. And then there's, like, a laundry list of stuff you have to get done. And it's like, all right, let's do it.
Yeah.
So YouTube is definitely, I mean, my fiance will tell you, I watch YouTube all day long.
Yeah.
YouTube is such a great medium to get your name out there.
Yeah.
And people just enjoy the experience. And the cool thing about leathercraft is it's an international trade. So people from all over the world just enjoy, you know, wallets. And, you know, there's a whole community about, you know, everybody's carries. And
people collect wallets. People use wallets. I mean, people always need something to hold their business cards. I mean, it's a necessity for our life.
Right.
It is.
Yeah.
Definitely.
I mean, that's kind of, if you know me, you know I go through hobbies. You know, I've gone through a dozen hobbies, especially in like the past 5 years. And then one day I just picked up leathercraft because, you know, I wanted something that I could do at my table, that I could sit and I could, you know, be with my fiance or watch TV or, you know, just be there. And then it just kind of started growing. And so this is the one hobby that stuck. And then I had one person reach out, and my first sale, it's actually kind of creepy. He sold it. I sold him a wallet in the yellow and red color. And I was so desperate to sell that wallet that I met him, like, in person. I was like, meet me in the REA parking lot in Santa Fe, and I'll exchange it with you. Like, that's how desperate I was, just to be like,
to show him,
take my stuff.
Yes, yes. I don't blame you. I would have been doing the same thing.
Yeah.
Get my name out there, for sure.
Sometimes that's what it takes.
Thank you so much, brother.
Yeah, Patrick, man.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming on, dude.
Big head.
Great stuff.
Yeah,
Big Head Leather, you guys, don't forget that. www.bigheadleather.com.
And at Big Head Leather on Instagram and Facebook.
You want to shout out your phone number or you have a business phone?
Yeah, sure. It's 505-470-4161. Text me, call me. Not too late. But
We got a lot of good people out here tonight, and Patrick and Eric are some of them. Come check out their work, some check out their quality. It's worth it.
Yes.
Definitely worth it.
Yeah.
Real quick before we end this little segment, shout out to Tanya's Tasty Kitchen. She just gave us some gold bars and they were pretty bomb, so.
Yeah.
And thank
if,
you.
And Tanya. If anybody saw the eclipse, it was mine and Patrick's head blocking out the sun. That's all it was.
That's on brand right
there. We'll be back. We'll be back.
Thank you, guys.
That was it for me. Yeah, I like that.
Cool. All right. Yeah. Welcome back, guys. We're back again.
505 Uncut.
We had to have a little lunch break, and the wind is starting to kick up, so sorry about that.
At the ABQ Collective.
Yeah.
We got some more guests, a lot of good people out here today. Nazario Sandoval, local artist.
Nazario, brother.
Oh, Nazario, my bad.
That's a tough one. You got to say it like Anglos and you did Nazario.
Yep, there you go.
And Celia?
Celia.
Celia.
Celia Cruz.
In the house.
I know that Nazario is you're a pretty well-known artist around town, right?
I've been moving around quite a bit. We did a lot of murals last year. It's pretty awesome.
Where have you done murals at?
Murals. So we did, I got together the Al Rey project. So that was a collective of 48 artists. Most diverse and eclectic group of artists ever assembled in Albuquerque. So that was a major feat. Like all the other ones are just little small ones that I did. But yeah. I think, you know, getting that many people together of all races and, you know, after the COVID and all that, I think it really, really brought a lot of people together and we uplifted the community. And so that was really what the main focus of that was. And it's amazing. It's still getting rave reviews and everyone taking pictures behind it. And that's what it's all about, making impact through art.
That's awesome, brother. What's your inspiration on all that kind of projects?
You know, more just kind of just being a community-based, starting leadership. I mean, I didn't choose this role, it chose me.
Yeah.
So, you know, trying to be a community leader, which that's not a word that fits in with what I initially thought I was going to be, but yeah. I think if it chooses you, you just kind of got to roll with it. And if you can have the momentum and get that many people together and create something amazing, I think that's really what is amazing about it, you know. And you let everyone do their thing and, you know, they showed up and showed out.
Nice, brother.
That's awesome.
Yeah. You have to have talent. You have to have, I mean, to be an artist, not everybody can come up with things and draw and put stuff on walls and make it look really, really good. And we've seen some of your work and it's amazing, brother.
Yeah, and it takes guts to be an artist. I mean, whether you're on the mic, whether you have a can or a paintbrush or you're a photographer, I mean,
there's different ways of art.
There's a ton, and that's what we also got to celebrate too, because there's, you know, with the social media, there's a wide window of how we can get it out.
Opportunity.
There. Yeah, and if we can work with photographers, if we can work with other creatives, whether they, you know, say words or they take pictures or they're models, I mean, I think there's an art to all of it. And, you know, also, you know, even what you guys do is
podcast,
an art.
It
takes time and it takes courage to be up here every day.
It absolutely takes courage. Yes,
absolutely. You could probably put him in with your sister. Would be a good little collaboration of some stuff. His sister is a designer, a local designer. Tell me a little bit about your sister's stuff.
Oh, she makes streetwear for ladies.
Okay.
Yeah, so she does a lot of stuff like that. She's really good, and she uses a lot of like art and stuff for.
She's always looking for
printings and stuff like that. You
guys can talk to her and maybe come up with something.
Absolutely, absolutely, and that's another thing too. Clothing too, and it all goes hand in hand.
Yeah,
because so many of so much of our art is put on clothing now.
Mm-hmm.
It is.
We gotta capitalize on it if we can.
Yeah. You
know, get murals, money off the mural, money off of this, and then, you know, take that money and then set some aside and then put it into other projects.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, yep.
Kind of keep...
Bury your money in.
Yeah.
Yep.
Reinvest.
Reinvest
in your community, too.
Yes, absolutely.
Right. Artists supporting artists.
Supporting artists. That's the best thing. We all got to support. And I think that's what I like about today is just everybody out here is supporting everybody else and just, you know... Everybody's selling their things that they've made or come up with designs, and everybody's looking at their different stuff, art, everything, and it's amazing how everybody's come together and support local.
Yeah, definitely. I recommend everybody comes out. Anybody that's watching this, when is the next event? They do this twice a month. I believe it's the second and fourth week of every month.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
It is.
First and second week of every month.
And we'll be also, so the reason why we're here too is Josh was doing his mural, and then we're going to actually expand on this wall that's over here to the right of us. And we're going to have 12 artists, and we're going to do something, you know, New Mexico related, and it's going to be awesome. So I was coming to check out the location and just kind of get a feel for what's going on here.
Yeah,
quick question.
Awesome.
What's the time length to do something like this? If you guys start from scraps, say, on an art project, does that take months, weeks?
It takes months, and it's more of the Zoom meetings, the email after the meeting. You know, it's almost like you got to take care of the executive stuff,
yeah,
and all the, you know, the things that come along with the emailing, and make sure that you're prompt on your responses, and everyone kind of builds it, and then it takes months to get to the wall.
To get to the wall and then actually start doing your work.
Right.
Wow. One thing that I enjoy here in Albuquerque, and I'm sure you guys have been there, is the Albuquerque Museum, the art museum.
Oh, yeah.
The pieces in there are amazing, aren't they?
Yeah, I just saw the Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera exhibit. Mind-blowing. I went and saw it 5 times.
Oh, my God. Mind-blowing, yes. The last one I think I went to see was the Muppets, when they had the Muppets there.
Oh,
and nice. That was amazing to see the Muppets.
Yeah, the Jim Henson. To see that one.
To see the actual Muppets there in the glass case and to see what they were on. Cool. Like, those were the ones I grew up watching on, you know? Watching the show, watching Sesame Street and all them, and to see them like that in person was really awesome. And I've seen a bunch of art there. There was even one where they had treasures and stuff from Spain, from like the 900s. And that was crazy to see, because a lot of the art back then was religious. It was like Catholic art, a lot of, you know, like Jesus and stuff on the paintings. But, I mean, you can tell those paintings were old, and was amazing to see in person.
Yeah.
Yeah, when they, at those times, that was their camera.
Yeah, that was
their
camera.
They captured the images.
Yeah, they did it by an artist would have to draw them.
That's literally the Instagram of the old days.
Mm-hmm. The old days.
It's kind of weird, you know, how it's transcended, but it's still the same thing.
Yeah,
because
yeah,
it's telling you about capturing a moment in time.
Wow. You were saying about a big project or something you guys were going to be announcing or coming up.
Yeah, what's so going we're going to do Burke Love Wall. That's going to be probably another 50 artists, and we're going to do all things Albuquerque, Burke. We're going to do like another Johnny Tapia, Danny Romero mural. We're going to do like a Holly Holmes. We're going to do like a sports segment of murals. And then it's going to also be like the Brian Urlacher, the Kenny Thomas, like all the great icons of sports in New Mexico. Because, yep, I mean, I think now I'm working with the New Mexico United, and I think that there's so much sports.
Yeah,
it relates to our lives. I mean, we will hurry up to go watch the game on Monday night, unfortunately.
Don't forget to put Derek Romero on that mural. I played Yaffle in my sophomore year. That was pretty good.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, that was in 1993.
Nice.
He also trained boxing for a little while, and he got a nickname, Puppy Power.
Yeah, that was
nickname.
A Puppy Power boxing.
Oh,
yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Nice.
I don't know if I should be proud of that name, but yeah, Puppy Power.
The world heard it. The world heard it here. Brought it back. Those names from the 90s still stay with us. Yeah. Okay.
And that was my coach, bro. I was hitting mitts with him one time, and he went first. And, you know, he's a big boy. He's a lot of power. Bomb, bomb. And even our coach was like, he has some power, Daniel. Dang. So then it was my turn, and I was doing the same combos and stuff. And then he was like, yeah, yeah, ooh, yeah, hit it. And he goes, dang, you got that puppy power, bro. You got that puppy power. I was like, dang. I was like, should I be prouder?
I don't know if that's a compliment or not.
So, yeah. I was definitely hitting the dumbbells after that, trying to get the arm stronger.
Yeah.
At least it was encouragement.
Yeah.
Motivation.
Yeah,
there you go. For sure.
So are you guys from Albuquerque originally? Or
I'm from Las Cruces originally.
I'm from El Paso, actually.
El Paso.
Yeah, I have family out here, and I come every once in a while, but ripping the border.
And are you an artist as well?
Yes, I'm a spoken word artist, poet. I've been doing some hip-hop. I do theater performance. I write, so I do...
Oh, that's awesome.
Oh, wow, that's awesome.
Lots of different things, yeah.
Yeah.
What's some of your work? Are you working on stuff right now, poetry and all that?
I am. I'm actually working on a compilation, an album called Tlet, which is T-L-E-T-L, and that is Nahuatl for fire.
Okay. Ah.
So, yeah, Nahuatl is an original Mexican language. So I'm just really excited to finally get some of my work out. I've been wanting to do it for years, so to finally be able to share that is exciting.
Yes, that is exciting.
That is exciting.
That is awesome. Good for you guys. That's awesome.
Are you gonna post it up on YouTube and all that kind of stuff, all that kind of platform?
Yeah. Right now, I have a Bandcamp, and I have a single out. So that's a Bandcamp. It's Celia, C-E-L-I-A-A.
Okay, cool. We'll have to definitely check that out. Everybody go check that out, for sure.
Definitely.
Yeah. So I'm excited to put more stuff up there and get these messages across. You know, I think it's important to tell our stories, so.
Yes, it definitely is.
And you guys are loaded with talent. Both you guys are loaded with talent. And that's what we want is everybody else to see that talent.
Yeah, I actually was painting live in Las Cruces, and she was one of the guest MCs there, and she captured me from her words.
Yeah.
And I brought her out here to perform at Art Walk last night as well.
Awesome.
And just, you know, off of that one connection and just her words, you know, resonated so well.
That's what hooked you. Yeah.
More people should hear it. And that's why we connected. And now
that inspiration.
Yeah.
How did that artwork go last night?
Oh, man, that was the most people I've seen.
Dude, it was popping.
Was it popping?
Yeah,
it was the most people I've seen downtown since 2005.
Wow.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Remember,
it's because everybody wants to do something
They're so ready. Yeah.
Eager. Eager to do something.
Yep.
That's awesome, guys. That's really awesome.
So you performed at the Art Walk? Was it on a stage out there?
Yeah, it was like super impromptu pop-up. We had a little PA system, like speaker and mic. That's all we need, right?
Oh,
I would have just done it with nothing. But yeah, it was awesome. I think we captured a little crowd at the perfect time. And for me, I think as long as you get one person that really connects, like that's enough for me, you know?
Yeah.
And I was... We did a couple of sets, just kind of spontaneous, and I was able to connect with some youth that were there.
Uh-huh.
So I think for me, that made this entire trip worth it. You
yes.
know, like even just making eye contact, and I had a piece specifically written for youth, so I took advantage, and I'm like, this is for you guys. And to make eye contact with this beautiful little girl and see her smile and feel represented and to see a little boy, make eye contact with him. And then afterwards, they wanted to take pictures. So, like, that's what's really important for me, right? To share these messages with people that they need to hear that sometimes.
Yeah.
Because I know sometimes I'll go to a show and I'm like, oh, my God, that resonates so much. And I'm so glad I made it here just for that.
Yes.
So I want to be able to do the opposite, right? Or to do that on my end. End where somebody shows up and they're there and they were meant to be there to listen to this message, and that's
it could be,
you know,
life changing
like
for somebody.
Sometimes.
Yeah, to take
Absolutely.
Something home with them, take something home positive with them from that,
and that's gotta
possibly
be so,
change their lives.
It's got to be so gratifying too when you write something and then just to see that it's actually connecting with somebody. Even I'm sure you write on your own experiences in life.
Yeah,
and then
everything
to see other
personal.
People resonate with that, that's got to be the everything about. Even just being an artist, whether it's poetry or rapping or painting or anything like that.
Yes.
Yeah,
it really
exactly.
means a lot. It makes all the difference.
Right.
It does.
And that's
does.
Why I do it, right? So that people can hear that they're not alone. You know, like a lot of us are feeling the same way. So you're not alone in your pain. You're not alone in your strength. You know, we're here for each other. So.
And that's what we need to change as human beings,
as a society,
exactly what you said. Like, people have been there, and there's people that care, and that can you. There's people that you can talk to, you know, or whatever. We need to stop with this whole selfishness and just everybody is about themselves and
this
not
racism.
Helping nobody and the racism. Yeah, we just need to grow as one and make this world peaceful and beautiful again, man.
Yeah.
I agree.
Too much violence.
Yeah.
It really is. you know, it's hard. I mean, you know, everyone, and then even more so now with the youth, and they're so stuck to these phones and they're stuck in this false sense of reality versus living in reality. And that's
the tough part. The phones are so awesome, but yet so bad at the same time.
Yeah, if you leave that at home, you're going to turn around and no one called you, and you'll go and get that phone because you thought that someone was
going to call you
or mess you.
Yeah, and then like if you break your phone or lose your phone, dude, you go through and like people are like, oh
panic mode.
I got to go to Verizon right now.
It's weird. Yeah. Like, man, we are just as bad as the kids.
Yeah.
Like, they're, you know, but...
The generations.
Yeah, it's changed.
I remember when... writing a letter to your friend was the bit, like when I was little, you would write a letter.
Passing the letters?
Yeah.
The little
triangle letter. Yes.
Do you like me?
Oh,
yes,
shoot, that went to the wrong person.
Check the squares and all that. Yeah. It's crazy how society and how, you know, the generations have just changed. The technology has changed the world.
As
I check my phone.
Yeah. We'll edit that part out.
And we are on YouTube. Also.
That just goes back to show how stuck that we are to these things. Like,
yeah.
I mean, and then especially when you get into business, it's like, if you miss a message or you're not responding fast enough, you're like, I mean, seriously, you can miss an opportunity.
And yes.
Like, you can miss an opportunity, and not only that, somebody could put a bad review on you just like that. Just for something so simple that it is just a mistake.
A misunderstanding can change a lot of things.
Yes.
I think the technology can be really convenient and serve a purpose, but it also, like a lot of times, impedes us from living in the moment that we're in, you know? Like even if we go to a show and everybody's on their phone and recording... And then I catch myself, I'm like, I don't want to catch this through a screen. Like, I want to live it live.
I feel the same way. Because, like, I remember one of the last shows we went to before the pandemic was that reggae band. What was it? Remember we all went together?
Yeah, it was
Slightly Stupid.
Stupid.
And I was all recording it, and in the middle of it, I was all... They're right there. Why am I looking at it through a stupid screen?
I catch myself doing that all the time. Yeah. I'm like, there's this tiny image, but they're on stage.
They're right there. Yeah.
And then when you look at the video, you can't even hear it. It's so distorted.
Yeah, it's all distorted and ruined.
Yeah, it's like, and then it's like.
And you get homeboy in front of you that puts his head right in front of your phone about four times.
What? Yeah.
Well, that and because we're the shortest people on earth, we're still reaching to get that top thing on the top shelf.
Right.
The tallest guy is always going to find me. He's going to stand right in front of me. Don't matter where. I can be anywhere. He's going to find me.
Yeah. Sorry, I think I've been that person.
Oh, see?
And with my hair, when I wear my bun. I'm like 6'2".
and you're all set. No, you sit down. You're like, all right, cool. I can see it. Perfect show. Nobody's in front of me. And then right when the show starts, here they come. They're like, some tall person's coming right in front of you to sit down. You're all, not here.
Yeah.
I always feel really bad because I know that I do that to people. And I'm like, I'm sorry.
You have to slouch down like that.
Yeah. By the third drink, I don't even care anymore.
Yeah.
That's funny.
I'm like, woo, look around me.
That's funny.
Dance.
Find a way.
Dancing.
I'm enjoying myself.
Yeah. For sure.
So let me ask you guys your opinion right quick. Our show's called the 505 Uncut. But I had told Daniel that we should have named it the Double D Show. Derek and Daniel.
Yeah.
Isn't that a catcher?
It is. But depending on who your fan base is.
Yeah.
Would it catch people's attention, though?
It would.
But
I think you want to call it.
I'm not on board with that.
I think you're going to call it something that they can be easily.
It could be it could resonate with anybody.
Because you want to have a brand name, you can't really put that on a shirt.
Yeah.
What if we put a big D and then like we'll finish the little letters of my name and then big D and then your little letters.
Little letters.
Yeah.
So it says Derek and Daniel, but then there's two.
It's all about marketing.
D's.
I would actually put in the comments below what you think.
Yeah.
That's where you can get what your feedback you is.
Feedback.
Your people that actually
your
watch.
Audience. Because
you gotta feed off of. Our ideas are not what everyone else's ideas are.
Yes, exactly.
But I like 505 Uncut.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But Double D means something else to me. So yeah. I'm like, I don't know how I feel about that.
It's kind of offensive.
You might lose.
It's kind of, it's so like, what is this show
woman.
About?
Yeah, exactly.
Should this even be on YouTube?
Yeah.
Or should this be on Brazzers?
Is this?
but we're all talking about it, so that's good.
Yeah. Is it? I mean, then you might want to, if you want to do a Double D, then it's got to be like at a Hooters setting. You guys are putting yourself in a weird box.
Daniel were always trying to come up with a name, and we came up with 505 Uncut, but we were trying to aim away from 505 Uncut, but then we had to go back to our roots, and then we came up with 505 Uncut. So.
Yeah. Well, and that's just, you know, it's kind of that number, that sign. Yeah. What we are.
The symbol.
That's who we are.
Yeah. You know?
Well, when we were first coming up with the name, we wanted to stray away from the New Mexico thing, the Zia sign and the 505 and Burke and all that.
It's because everybody has it.
Yeah. But now when our show starts, a Zia sign comes up and the 505 comes up. So, we're everything we didn't want to do, we did it anyway.
You got to stay real.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, that's just who we are.
I left New Mexico and lived in Colorado for 16 years. And, like, I would have never thought that coming back to New Mexico that I'd become 10 times bigger in my art career than...
Really?
By coming home and embracing my heritage, my people, and embracing everything that was, like, you know,
well,
growing
I think
up.
We have some
you know,
of the most beautiful art here in New Mexico.
Yeah, definitely. And
most of the beautiful art is New Mexico, and that's your roots, bro.
Yeah,
and you exactly. know, like, the Latino scene and the lowrider scene and stuff, that's real prevalent here. I mean, that's in Cali, too, and all that. But even overseas, man, like in Japan and in China, yeah, it's super big over there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's big.
That cholo.
Which is
super
pretty
big.
Crazy because that's us. You know what I mean? That's how I remember. I used to drive lowrider bikes when I was a kid.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And my dream was to have a car with hydraulics and, you know what I mean, the Dickies all the workwear and all that stuff. And now it's like all over the world.
Yeah. Well, my childhood was La Bamba movie, bro. When they go to that house, that was my grandma's house, bro.
Yeah.
Grandma's house, straight up, dirt backyard. House barely put together, the door barely hanging on, but everybody was having fun. Yep. Music, everything.
And then after that movie came out, you used to go in the backyard, Richard!
Yeah. Playing Sleepwalker, play Sleepwalker on your cassette tape and then try to hold the tears back, bro.
Yeah.
that's the shit. La Bamba, American Me, all those little Chicano movies are...
Yep.
They hit home a lot. A lot of those movies, those Pachucos and Chicanos remind me of my uncles and them. And so.
But a lot of those things that, you know, we did in the 90s and early whatever, like as coming up, whatever, like, you know, that made us who we are today. And that's like sometimes we forget that. Like if it wasn't for all this tagging letters to letter base to this art, it's an evolution. And it's
Because it used to be bad. Really bad back in the day, like with the tagging and just defacing, you know what I mean? And now some of those taggers have grown into becoming some of the best artists that are out there right now.
And business people.
And
business people, yep.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
But it's about evolution and evolving. Right. You can control your own destiny.
The choices that you make in life.
Yes, absolutely.
That's awesome. Good. That's good stuff, guys.
Yeah, for sure.
Real good stuff. So you have the future coming up with the athletic wall with all the, and what other little projects you guys got coming up? You have any poetry coming up back home in El Paso?
Were you going to hit anything else while you're out here?
I'm just like, I'm sorry.
Were you going to do anything else while you were out here? You're
right
just visiting,
here, right now.
Yeah. Right here, right now.
she was going to get up, but I think we didn't have the right. She was going to get up and say some words, but it might not be the right time. It's a good. You got to get the vibe.
You got to feel the vibe. Yeah. It's just like when you're painting too, right? You got to be in the mood.
Right.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have to get yourself in the mood, though. You know, I've had a lot of shows where I'm like, man, I don't want to do nothing. But then you get there, and you know, once you're on stage, it's a completely different story.
Yes.
But what do I have coming up? Stuff just comes to me randomly.
Yeah.
Somebody asked me too, like, oh, when's your next show? What are you doing next? Just whatever next show comes up. And I'm like, yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
Because I always have, like, it's funny how things happen. The things that you're meant to do come to you, you know?
Yeah.
So, but right now I'm just focusing on getting this album out. Actually realized that I need to write more like uplifting stuff because I write a lot about like social justice issues and cultural identity, historical trauma type things, and I think it's really important, right? It's important to tell all of these stories so that we know what's going on, but at the same time sometimes it gets really heavy, you know, so we have to have like most of the stuff, I kind of switch it at the end. And I'm like, all right, we got
to
bring in the good message.
Yeah.
But I need some like feel good stuff, you know, where people are just going
to
be like, yeah.
Yes.
So that's what I'm working on next.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
That's good.
You got to have the good times, too.
Exactly, right? It's a balance.
Yes.
Yeah.
Definitely, guys.
Just like Thanos on the Avengers, there's balance.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm
doing some work with the New Mexico United Soccer Club. We have some stuff coming up. I'm booked till August.
You're blessed, brother.
Yeah, brother. Exactly. But, you know, I always will take the time to try something new, too, like this.
Yes, and thank you for that, bro. We really appreciate it.
I appreciate you letting us.
We'd like to hear you guys' Instagram handles and Facebook and all of that, if you guys got them.
Yeah, sure. I'm at Wemford, at WEMFER, and Nazario Sandoval. I appreciate the time.
So y'all can find me on Facebook. That's Celia Aguilar, CeliaAguilar. And I would suggest looking me up on Instagram the same way, because my name, my handle is Celia Cuautlilhuicat, which is actually Nahuatl. Nobody can spell that. I have to sound it out when I'm writing it for somebody. But that's my name translated into Nahuatl. It's a celestial eagle.
Awesome. Nice. That's awesome. Yeah.
That is awesome.
That's cool.
Yeah, because you wrote it down over here, and I was all, you're going to have to say that, because I can't say that.
I was trying to sound it out, too, but it didn't sound like that.
What did it sound like?
We went to Rio Grande High School, which I know you don't know that, but you do.
I was going to say Kalanti Ahala, or Ahali.
Hala, hala, hala.
Yeah.
Hala.
Yeah, something like that. But I was way off.
Well, we appreciate the opportunity.
Yeah, we appreciate you guys coming on. Definitely check it out. Yes,
sure.
Support local.
Check them out, you guys. 505 Uncut. 505 Uncut. All right, back again, you guys.
505 Uncut.
We got the DJ Lil Salsa with us. Hell yeah, dude. I've been listening to the music. Sounds good, man.
Yeah, thank you, man. I appreciate it. Been out here vibing pretty much all morning. So.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, heck yeah.
Thanks for good vibes. I wanted to do the DJ Lil Salsa in the house.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Yeah, just, I know you guys probably, if you guys have any questions for me, if you want to get to know me a little bit more.
Yeah, how long you been a DJ, brother?
So I started about 3 years ago, just kind of messing around, and just because I used to go to so many festivals and so many raves, I got really into the EDM scene. So I was like, man, I hear this guy doing this and that guy doing this, I could do it better.
Yeah.
But, you know, so I do it my own flavor, add the spice, add the sauce.
Yeah.
That's just where it started. So now 3 years later, it's going good.
Man. Do you follow like all the BPMs and all that stuff, or vibe it?
Oh yeah, you have to.
You have to follow the BPMs,
it's
huh?
It's the science of DJing.
Yeah,
you know? Like it's all about the vibe of the track, your bassline, your beat, your BPM.
Yeah,
and you know you got to switch up artists every now and then, make it interesting, make it flavorful. So that's like the big thing. That's why I really like going by Lil Salsa. You know, a lot of DJs out here will just play, you know, whatever they think the crowd wants to hear, you know, whatever's popular. But for me, bro, I really vibe with stuff that's more on the underground side, and I like to keep things interesting with like remixes of popular stuff.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I noticed that. You've done that, yes.
Yes, so you'll hear things you recognize, but it'll be a brand new
beat. A new beat, yeah.
So that's something I really like to do. Yeah.
Hell yeah, dude. That's really cool.
Yeah, heck
yeah. I always wanted to be a DJ too when I was in our high school years?
High school years.
Because like grad parties and USC, you know, like the DJs tearing it up and all that, but I just never did it. You?
It takes a lot of practice, dude.
I know you did guitar for a while.
Yeah, I wanted to be a DJ too, but it just takes too much practice, bro. You really got to have a love for it, man.
Yeah,
the passion. Definitely.
Yeah, there's always been art in my life too. Like my dad is artist El Moises. So he's pretty well known out here and world renowned as well too in the lowrider scene, you know, the art scene, the Chicano scene. So I've always been around art, and they really pushed me to pick up music at a young age.
I think I might have a piece from your dad.
Yeah, El Moises.
Did he do the little Chihuahua smoking us? I got that original one.
With the tattoo.
I own the original one.
With the bandana.
With the bandana, yeah. I got it in my living room, dude.
Yeah, see, small burke.
Yeah. When they finally were gonna sell it at Por Vida, I mean not Por Vida, at Masks y Mas.
Yes.
Well, they were just copying it, right? Copying it, and I was like, I want the original one, and they didn't want to sell it at first. And finally, it went up for sale, and boom, I got it.
That's Kiko's fault for not buying it first, bro.
Yeah. I got it. And it ain't going nowhere.
No, cool. That's awesome.
It's on the mantle.
Yeah.
Yep. Heck yeah. Yeah,
that's
I have
tight.
A couple pieces myself at home. Just bigger pieces. I'm like, damn, dad, are you sure you want to give this to me? He's like, yeah, Mico, that's all you, bro. And, you know, have the big, the couple and the lowrider down the barrio.
Yeah.
He's giving me the Diego and Frida piece. So really fortunate to have, you know, especially him as, you know, a good role model in my life. So
it's a blessing right there.
Yeah, that's really good, man. Yeah, hell yeah.
That's awesome, brother. So what's up in the future, brother? You have any festivals coming up, DJs?
So with everything opening back up, you know, hopefully do some more local stuff before traveling out. The last kind of thing I was looking to do was something up in Colorado. Me and my boy Gabe, he came out to support, but we have a group called No Heads. Shout out No Heads. But yeah, we do a bunch of different music. We play everything from dubstep to trap to hip hop to house. So we like to go out and do stuff. But yeah, Colorado was the next move, but we'll see if that comes back around. But for now, just open air, just vibing, whoever's down to just hang out.
Yeah.
That's kind of what it's at right now.
So. Yeah, it's nice that things are starting to open up again, man, and get back to regular life.
Yes, yes, I can hardly wait, man.
Yeah.
Can hardly wait.
I mean, even just being here, man, there was a bunch of people here, and there's still a lot, but man, it's just, it feels good to get out. Oh, yeah. I heard the art walk was bumping last night.
Shout out to the people that do art walk.
Yeah.
Last night was the biggest I've ever seen downtown pop off, man.
Really?
Yeah, it was pretty wild.
Dang, we missed out, dude.
We missed out.
Yeah, definitely.
Were you playing downtown last night, too?
I didn't play, no. I had some homies there, and then I you know, Josh doing the mural. I got a bunch of homies, you know, Canvas Artistry. Shout out to Jesus and Herman. But, you know, they got a bunch of artists. I got to meet a bunch of people there bartending. So show up to the event and, you know, have a good time, and you get to support your homies. And
you meet a lot of good new people too. You meet a lot of good new people.
Yeah, definitely, man.
And there's a lot out here in New Mexico.
I felt like we met a lot of good people today, man. And you know, including you, I've been enjoying the music, man.
Yes, thank you. And thank you for understanding about the recording and all that stuff, bro.
Yeah, for sure.
We got to share the space, right?
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
No problem at all.
And it was perfect, dude. We invested in some new mics so that, because we knew that there was going to be music.
Cool.
So it worked out just fine, man. Hell yeah.
What's funny is I brought my little home speakers because I wasn't sure what kind of gear they were going to have.
Yeah.
So it probably would have been no problem earlier, just me trying to blast my little speakers, but it worked out perfect.
It did work out perfect.
Awesome. Yeah, heck yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Why don't you plug in your Instagram, Facebook? You have any followers?
Yeah, plug yourself. So Instagram, Moises is Moises, Lil Salsa, LilSalsa. And then just look me up, Moises Salcedo on Facebook. I'm on Twitter too. And I got all kinds of stuff in the works. I got music coming out. I also do t-shirts. I like bleach shirts and do custom prints and stuff. So I got all kinds of stuff. So hit me up, guys.
DJ Little Salsa.
All right, you guys, I think that's it for today.
505 Uncut, we out.